Can you please write in the chat how do you call the first compound? No, that's not carbon, that's calcium. Very good, calcium bromide. Take a look. In English, what we do in the first place is we say the name of the cation. I'm gonna zoom in. Okay. So we first, in English, we first write the name of the cation, then the root of the anion, plus IDE. That's how you write it in English, okay? That's why the name of this compound in English is calcium, which is the cation, and then the root, which is brom, and then the suffix IDE. Calcium bromide. Very simple. This is a ionic compound binary, okay? So it's very simple to name. But in Spanish, what we do is we first start with the anion, okay? First with the anion, and then we're going to say the name of the cation. So, in the first place, what we do is we write the roots plus a suffix, but in this case the suffix is not sorry. Okay, I continue. Okay, so in Spanish, how are we going to do this? We're going to start with the anion, sorry, in the first way, by writing the root plus the suffix. But in Spanish, the suffix is not IDE. The suffix is uro. The suffix in Spanish is not IDE. So the name in Spanish then is going to be the root of bromine is brom. Then the suffix sería uro. Bromuro, bromuro. We're going to write the bromuro de calcio. Very good. Vamos a escribir el artículo de, and then the name of the cation, that in this case is calcium. In Spanish, you know, it's just calcio. So the name in Spanish will be bromuro de calcio. Okay. Another way to do that is interchange the or change the position. Sorry, of here. Bromide, which is going to be bromuro, and calcium, that is in Spanish, will be just calcio. And in between, you will write the article de. Let's try it with one more example. Okay, MgCl2. Take a look. How would you call that compound in English and how would you call it in Spanish? In English, it's very simple. Very good. Magnesio, that would be the name in Spanish. Okay? So in English it will be magnesium chloride. Y en español sería, ya les dije, cambiamos la posición. Okay. Entonces en vez de chloride, en Spanish sería cloruro. Cloruro. El artículo de, and then the name of the cation that in here is magnesio. In Spanish, magnesium is magnesio. Cloruro de magnesio. So as you can see, it's quite simple. The naming system is a little bit different, but in the end, the concept is the same. Anion plus suffix. Estamos hablando de un anión con un sufijo. El anion es la parte negativa. Okay? Chloride, cloruro. Bromide, bromuro. Fluoride, fluoruro. Okay? Siempre va a terminar en uro. Siempre que sea en binary, termina en uro. Now, very quick in the chat, can you please write the name of this one? In Spanish only. Can begin exactly fluoruro de sodio. Okay, so you can begin. If you do not adapt, try to write the name in English and then do translation. Okay, you can start from there. Hay quienes le dicen sódico. Okay, so the name in Spanish, I told you, sería fluoride, sería fluor, uro, fluor, o sea, la root es la misma en ambos, si se fijan. But the only thing that changes is the suffix, fluoruro, sodio. Now, what happens if you have a polyatomic ion? An ionic compound with polyatomic ion. How can we? So, as you remember, the name in Spanish is, the name in English is nitrate. Okay? Nitrate. Okay? Entonces, nitrate se transforma al español como nitrato. Don't you ever try nitrato, okay? So, what you do is basically the same method. The name in English is barium nitrate. So in Spanish, nitrate sería nitrato de bario. Now let's try this one. atomic ion in English is called sulfite. Okay? Sulfite. But in Spanish, eso se conoce como sulfito. O sea que le vamos a quitar la E por el O. Sulfito. Okay? So the name is going to be. English was silver sulfide, then in Spanish will be sulfito de silver, que sería plata. Sulfito de plata. Nickel. ¿Qué nickel es ese? ¿Nickel 2 o nickel 3? Este es nickel 3. Why? Because you don't see the charges crossed. Okay? This is the nickel 3. O hacen oxidation number. Dicen 1 nickel plus 3 oxygens plus 1. Aquí lo pueden hacer directamente mejor con el iron. Okay. Un nickel más un fosfato. This is another way that you can do it, by the way. Equals 0. You don't know nickel. But you know that phosphate, the entire phosphate is negative 3. So you isolate. And you say nickel equals 0. Then you say nickel minus 3 equals 0. So here you can actually see that nickel is 3, the charge. Okay? So the name in English will be nickel 3. And then the ion phosphate. Fight. Phosphite. Okay? In Spanish, there are two ways to name it in Spanish. Phosphite in Spanish is fosfito. Pero en español no vamos a hacerlo así. No es como que solo vamos a cambiar la O. No. El sonido PH in Spanish does not exist. We already have a letter for that. So we say fosfito. Directly. Ok. Fosfito de nickel 3. Ok. But there's another way to say it. You know, nickel is a transition metal that has two oxidation numbers. You have nickel 2 and you have nickel 3. So nickel 2 is the low oxidation number and nickel 3 is the greatest, which is the great oxidation number. So, when this occurs, in Spanish, what we do is, we can also name by following, this. ¿Se acuerdan cuando en los ácidos mirábamos las terminaciones ico, ic? Sulfuric, sulfurous acid. Lo mismo sucede en español, ¿ok? Para low oxidation number va a ser O's, terminación. Pero en español sería oso. And for the greatest oxidation number va a ser, en vez de ic, va a ser ico. ¿Ok? O sea, en otras palabras, aquí tenemos nickel 3. Nickel 3 va a terminar en ico. ¿Ok? Entonces decimos, otra manera de nombrarlo sería fosfito Niquélico. Niquélico. Para indicar que es el níquel con el maximum oxidation number. En el caso de este ejemplo de aquí abajo, it is different. Because yes, I have phosphate and yes, I have nickel. But the oxidation number of nickel in this place is 2. Okay? So because here we are using nickel 2, then the suffix is going to end in oso. So in English, the name is nickel 2 phosphate. In Spanish, it is fosfito nickel 2. Y si níquel se coloca acentuado. Aquí, yo no sé por qué, pero bueno, me equivoqué acá. No, es que el níquel en español se escribe así con Q. ¿Ok? Y con el acento. Níquel 3, níquel 2. I'm more used to the English nomenclature. That's probably the reason why I committed that mistake. Now. Because I'm using the low oxidation number, then I'm going to be using the suffix also. Okay? So the name is going to be fosfito niqueloso. Para indicar que es nickel 2. As you can see, the naming in Spanish is not too different. Esta nomenclatura que les puse aquí, like niqueloso, niquélico, esta la nomenclatura, if I'm not mistaken, the one that is called the traditional nomenclature. Ya casi no se usa porque, bueno, no todos los elementos que tienen multiple oxidation state tienen dos. A veces tienen más oxidation numbers. Entonces este sistema, este naming system era un poco confuso en ocasiones, porque podía referirse a un número de oxidación o al otro. So it was very confusing, and that's why it's no longer, I would say useful, because yes, it is useful, but now it's not widely used because of that reason. Because it can lead you to commit mistakes. Now that's all I wanted to say about naming. What do you think? Is it easy? Is it difficult? Is it easier a Google search? Remember, at college, in a class, you won't be available to use Google search. Okay, so you need to know at least the basic stuff. So what do you think? Is this an easy topic? Easier than in English, or in English is easier? What do you think? Both are easy. Okay, bueno, that's everything I wanted to say. I can continue with acids, but I have to continue better with the explanation about, with the review for the students who need it. so I'm going to start today. I know that I did a promise to teach you this before the school year end, so I feel like they need to keep on that. But in the end, guys, it's not too complex. Just follow your instinct and you're gonna be just fine. Also, you need to know some names in Spanish, but they're not too difficult to identify those elements. I mean selenium, aluminum. It's pretty. It's already given, so it's not too complex. Now, what do you need to know for the upcoming exams? What do you need to know for the upcoming exams? Okay, the most important thing to know is that I will be evaluating theory, organic chemistry, and hydrocarbons. For both topics, I did a presentation that I sent, okay? So the theory from those presentations is going to be included in the evaluation. So please keep it in mind, you're gonna need it, so. Oh, guys. Okay, besides the theory, you have to study, well, the more importantly, the hydrocarbons. So, remember, three main kinds, alkanes, alkenes, alkynes, and the how do you classify them is going to depend on the type of bond that you have. If you have single bond, alkanes, if you have double bond, alkenes, if you have triple bond, then it's gonna be alkynes. Now, only three topics. Yes. But remember that for each topic, you need to know the rule for cyclos and the rule that will include alkyls, special alkyls, and so on. Now we're going to start with alkane. I expect from your participations today, Arianis, Aridnet, Julio, Victor, okay? Because I want to confirm that you are actually here in the meeting. So tell me, in the example that you see in the whiteboard, I'm sorry, I need to do something else. In the example that you see there in the whiteboard, tell me, what is the parent chain? What is the parent chain? Okay, the parent chain that you guys draw before, this one, that one is incorrect because here I have seven carbons. Okay. But if I do the other parent chain that you just draw, and I will have eight carbons in total. So if I do like this, I have eight carbons, and eight is greater than seven, so this must be the parent chain. Always confirm your parent chain by counting the number of carbons. Now, everything that is attached the parent chain is going to be an alkyl. Take a look. There we have a special alkyl. Here we have two carbons, and here we have one carbon. This alkyl from the top, it refers to the halogen bromine, but bromine as an alkyl is going to be called just bromo. Okay. Two carbons is ethyl, and one carbon is methyl. Now, in the procedure, what we do, and I don't know, Shayla, if you are there, turn the camera on. In the procedure, you have to do both the path, red and blue. Now, from the alkyls that I have here in this example, which one goes first? Which one must be written first? I expect your participation. Ariane, Sarine, Julio, Victor. Okay, ethyl begins with E. Methyl begins with M. But here, bromo begins with B. Entonces, alfabéticamente, bromo tiene que ir primero because it begins with B. Comes before E. Okay? Entonces, bromo tiene que ser. No tiene que ser ethyl. So you need to be very careful. Now tell me. What color is better for the name? Si yo tengo que ordenar primero bromo, ¿qué color voy a escoger para nombrarlo? Blue, that is correct. Yo voy a tomar el color azul porque es el número más pequeño. Recuerden, I'm going to focus on bromo because it begins with B, then with ethyl, then methyl. Alphabetically, that's how you arrange them. Entonces, me enfoco primero en el primer alquil que tengo que nombrar, que es bromo. Bromo comienza con B y está en la posición 3, más pequeña. Okay, the least number is position 3, and that is blue color. So I say, the bromo is located in the position 3, followed by azul, which is in the position 4. And then, followed by methyl, which is in the position 6. Now, how do we call the parent chain that has 8 carbons?
Octane,
very good. Okay. That is going to be the name. But sometimes, guys, you write the names differently. Like, for example, you say you make this 3-bromo-4-ethyl-6-methyl-octane. Okay, if I read it, there's no difference. If I just read it, there's no difference. Pero, de forma escrita, sí hay una diferencia. Okay? Por ejemplo, all names in organic chemistry, all names are written in lowercase. Por lo tanto, bromo, ethyl, que están, y octane, que están en uppercase, eso podría ser la respuesta de forma incorrecta. Another mistake here in this name is between 3 and Bromo, there is missing a dash. Okay? Recuerden, siempre separamos números de letras. That's why I need to include a dash. Y luego, entre letra y letra no hay separación. Por eso que tenemos methyloctane in a single word, todo junto, todo pegado, lowercase. It is different from this one. Methyl dash octane. Ahí está totalmente equivocado porque, bueno, en primer lugar separa lo que no debe separar y pues además the uppercase in octane. Pues hay dos razones ahí para que esté incorrecto, solo desde ese punto de vista. So this is going to be the right name. So you need to be careful, always lowercase. Always lowercase and always separate numbers from letters with a dash. Now sometimes we're gonna have this a cycle, okay? So you know this is a cycle, this is called methyl and this is called ethyl. Okay? So alphabetically the one that comes first going to be ethyl y luego methyl. Entonces, en cyclos nos vamos a enfocar también en la parte alfabética. Alfabéticamente, ethyl comes first y como ethyl comes first, el carbon donde está pegado ese ethyl va a ser mi primer carbon. Okay. So I have my first carbon here. Y voy a hacer a two path. Clockwise y counterclockwise. What color is the best for naming? Red or blue? Solo veamos el número de ethyl tiene el mismo número, so I don't need to compare. Pero methyl tiene números diferentes. In this case, methyl está en red, el más pequeño. So I'm gonna call it from the red color. So it's gonna be 1-ethyl, 3-methyl. Y luego el name of the parent chain, que estamos hablando que es un ciclo de 5 lados, que sería cyclopentane. And now this is going to be the name.